Double play in position-specific skills by Brian Green with the University of Kentucky. We're going to talk about six things that can affect your double plays positively. Catch play, fielding the ground ball, the positioning adjustment that we'll make to turn the double play skills and drills, position-specific drills, and how you can use charts to positively affect your player's concentration skills. How can catch play positively affect double play skills? We're going to look at two basic things in terms of our catch play program: how we start catch play with our exchange, and then how we move into quick feet and quick hands at the end of our catch play session. We're going to use the term exchange a lot. When we open up our catch play program, we are thinking about keeping the glove up. This is the introduction to our catch play without using our feet. The glove is up, and we're trying to catch the ball into the heel and exchange it quickly into our hands. Demonstrating here as a freshman about 3 weeks into our program, he's working on simply keeping the fingers up and exchanging it as quickly as he can into his hand. From about 15 feet apart, this is called quick hands, quick feet. This is an exchange program. It is nothing more than getting into an athletic position with your hands up. See the baseball first before you make your move. See it, react to the ball with fingers up, it's exchange, and then it's quick feet back to your partner. Again, errors can occur here where we make moves without properly evaluating it. We're athletic, the hands are up, we see it first, then we exchange and get it right back to our partner. This is a clip of Omar Vizquel that we grabbed right off of YouTube. I don't think there's any greater motivator for your players to look at what the best in the world looks like. His hands are up. He's constantly working on his exchange and he's having fun doing it, but notice where he's making the exchange or that deflection. The ball is off of the heel of the glove, which allows him to just deflect it and get it into his throwing hand. This is something your players can use as a motivator in terms of what the best in the world looks like. In terms of fielding the ground ball and the exchange being the separator, I think you've got to start with the catch position. If you can understand the catch position in terms of where you need to be, I think it can allow you to work into proper timing in terms of how you want to approach the baseball. As you look at the four major league infielders on this slide, one thing to notice is where are their eyes? And we talk a lot about staying under and behind. You can see in those major league infielders, you can see their eyes. They're behind the ball, they're underneath the ball, and they've got vision. And a lot of times with infielders, we will get late, the glove will get deep, and we won't have vision into the glove. So we talk a lot about staying under and behind. Our absolutes in terms of fielding the ground ball, we have pre-pitch rhythm. We read and recognize, this is the evaluation of the hop. We stay under and behind at the catch position. We secure that catch, and we take that catch in terms of the exchange to our belt, which leads us into separation, and then we move our feet through the throw. Starts with pre-pitch. We evaluate, and then at that catch position, staying in under and behind is critical. In relation to double play skills, the exchange will be the separator in terms of being able to catch it and get rid of it. When we talk about pre-pitch rhythm, this is Roger Federer, again, another clip taken off of YouTube. A great resource for us all the time. We can go online and find things. When we're talking about needing to react either left or right to 140 mile an hour serve coming back at you, notice Roger Federer's position. He has rhythm, there's a short hop, the feet go slightly outside his shoulder, and he's in that athletic position. Shown here is both in a Wimbledon coverage as well as practice footage. And I think the thing to notice here is that he's taking his practice into his game. We use this tennis example as our pre-pitch rhythm in terms of what does the body look like in an athletic position, ready to move. Another example taken off of YouTube. This is Evan Longoria in a practice setting. Again, to watch, there's rhythm, moving into a pre-pitch athletic position, and he's doing it constantly in his practice. There's three fungos here in a row, and the move remains the same all the time. You could almost assume that there is a trigger here because he's doing it over and over and over again. The great thing to watch on this pre-pitch rhythm in terms of taking your practice to the game is we start with this practice clip, and now notice in the game, with the bolt that's hit to his left, he gets to that athletic position once again, makes a great play. And even more interesting to note is the entire infield's doing it. You see footage of the middle. Both the middle guys are in that athletic position ready as the ball enters the hit zone. As Moe's moving over to first base, Carlos Peña has a short hop. He gets to that athletic position and he is ready. The entire infield is doing it. And that's what we're talking about in terms of trying to get into a routine of getting in with your pre-pitch rhythm and stepping out, being ready for the next pitch, and repeating that move again constantly, 150, sometimes up to 175 times a game on defense. Pre-pitch rhythm is critical. Now let's talk about fielding the ground ball. This is an example of Taylor just walking through. Taylor Black, a senior shortstop at Kentucky, just walking through how you field the ground ball. Most importantly, you're always trying to create an angle towards your target. You'll see here a couple of steps slightly to his right, but he's making moves towards the baseball. He's not taking himself outside and around or wasting steps. He's getting to the outside so he can allow himself to catch that ball glove side from the middle of his body slightly to his left foot or slightly glove side. As he approaches the ball, the glove comes out first, then it's right leg, left leg to catch. A critical move is to get that glove out first so we can ensure that at that catch position, we are under and behind. If it's simply a right-left to catch move, you have the opportunity at times to be late with your glove or deep. Again, it's get to the outside or create that angle towards your target. The glove leads the initial movement or the trigger. It's right, then left leg to the catch position where we catch a glove side. We're under and behind at catch. We secure the catch with our throwing hand. The glove and the hand come to the belt and find its way over near that throwing shoulder. Then it is a heel-to-heel or an aggressive footwork towards your target. Get glove side on the catch, get under and behind, center that exchange with the top hand, get it into your hand as quick as you can, and move your feet towards your target. Let's stay with fielding the ground ball in terms of the backhand. A couple of different types of backhands that can occur. We have backhand rhythm or we're playing through it, or we replace our feet. On the backhand rhythm, this is where your glove side or your left foot is in front of your right leg. And what you're trying to do here is always stay under and behind the catch, but at that catch position, as you are behind it, meaning the eyes are behind the glove, we make the catch with the weight firmly on our right leg, and on catch, we aggressively move the feet in terms of a shuffle or a heel to heel towards our target. Over there on the right slide, if you happen to have to replace your feet or the left foot crosses over, you've got to replace your feet as athletic and as quickly as you can. This means stay under and behind, catch and secure first, then replace the feet, and stay strong on that right leg. Rhythm drill. This is a drill we do every day at Kentucky. I think you'll notice a couple of things that the guys are constantly working on. The proper mechanics of staying under and behind. As you watch our infielders roll through this rhythm drill, we're trying to catch it and get rid of it and eliminate that middle step. I think if you can constantly work at that type of pace where the runner is getting down the line, if the game allows you or if you need less time, you're prepared. But if you have more time, you can always take the extra shuffle. Again, we get to the outside, the glove leads, it's right left to catch, we secure it, and we immediately come to the belt, it's heel to heel and throw. Again, it's critical to be able to exchange it at catch. As that glove is coming up to your belt, that ball is in your right hand. The glove leads, it's right-left to catch, we make the exchange, and then it's heel-to-heel. Constantly working at a catch and get rid of and eliminating that middle step. This can ensure that your infielders aren't sped up when the game allows it or could possibly make it happen. The guy's getting down the line, you're working at that pace constantly of catching it and getting rid of it. It's going to ensure your infielders or prepare them to be confident when somebody's getting down the line aggressively or fast. Concluded here, a standard positioning for our alignment in terms of where we are for a right-handed or left-handed hitter when we're straight up. Obviously, you'll have different alignments if you're at a slight pull or a pull position. But it's important to note here that your guys understand where they are in a standard straight up versus right or left-handed hitter, so they know when they make that adjustment in terms of the double play, they've got a good starting position, the adjustment that's made is proper. When we make the positioning adjustment for the double play up the middle, we like our middle guys to take three good solid steps in, and then two over to pinch the middle. We're obviously trying to come in and take that away, as well as moving closer to the base so we can turn the double play. Your third baseman will hold, he will only make an adjustment in, and we won't give away the line. His adjustment will just be two in. But in the middle, we tell our guys three in and two over. This is a diagram taken right out of the NC2A handbook. This is the force play rule. Where are we protected or where are we open? When we work in double plays, we talk about dominating the basic turns, and there's basically three of them. Where your second baseman will come across, the throw takes him arm side, or if he's going to need to open up where he's outside of the line. If you can prepare your guys for these three turns, they'll be equipped to see the ball and to react to whichever angle the ball takes them. We talk about dominating the three basic turns. The throw is either going to take your shortstop to the inside or the outside of the line, with the flips coming either from the second baseman or the first baseman, or coming from the middle of the field, from the pitcher or the catcher. The next slides will demonstrate, and as you watch the next slides, from the second baseman you'll see a flip coming from a coach, a tabletop, or an underhand feed. And then you'll also notice that balls are coming from the middle of the field or from the first base side. I think it's a great opportunity for your guys to set up machines and to give them big repetition, a lot of them in short distance throws, and set those machines up with the same feeds so they can get comfortable in terms of what to do with specific balls thrown. Here's the 4-6-3 turn with your shortstop. The feed here coming from the second baseman. This is a coach just flipping the ball to the shortstop. Again, notice as they approach, the hands come up, they get to an athletic position, but they properly evaluate the ball first. Two errors can occur on this play in terms of improper technique. One, the shortstop can fly towards the right field side, opening up his front side and making his arm drop, give you the opportunity for a bad throw. So the first thing you want to tell your shortstops is when they get that throw, close off that glove side. Get in line to first base. The second thing is they want to make sure that they see it first before they make their move. So as they approach the ball, the hands come up, they see it, and once they see the ball, then they can make their move through the base. Swiping the bag with their right foot, they make the catch and exchange, turn the glove side, front side closed, and then aggressively move the feet toward your target at first base. Here's a feed coming from the middle of the diamond. We've got a machine set up in between the catcher and the pitcher, and we're just giving them constant repetitions with a short 15 to 20 foot throw. Again, notice as they approach the base, they get to an athletic position and they're moving to get to the base quickly, but as they get close to the base, they get under control. Evaluate the ball and see it first. Errors again can occur here where your guys come too early through the base. We'll even notice on some of these that our guys will come to the base and stop because the ball hasn't been fed. As you approach it, you're athletic, your hands are up, you see it first, then you catch an exchange and go through the base. Another machine here for our first baseman feeding to the shortstop. This is that example again. It's a short throw, 15 to 20 feet. Our guys are set up early, but what we're really working on here is making sure that we don't cross that line. The runner is at first base, the first baseman is on the base, he comes over and up, releases the ball to the shortstop, and he wants to stay inside. The first baseman will feed inside, and your shortstops here are getting the opportunity to just practice staying inside. The left foot makes the touch of the base, then we close the shoulder off, stay inside, and move the feet aggressively back towards our target. On the next slides, we'll demonstrate the second base turn, the come across turn, the arm side, and the open up turn. Basically, if you can dominate these three turns, you'll be prepared for any angle that is fed to you to make that pivot. We'll demonstrate coming across with a machine and a coach flip. Arm side will be a flip from a coach, as well as the open up will be a machine. I like to use those machines because you can get big repetition in a short amount of time, and you can prepare your guys to read that angle and then make the proper turns. We'll start with an example of our come across turn. Typically the throw here will be from the third baseman, where you'll have time to come across the base, as well as a shortstop giving you an underhand feed. The important things to look at here are your second baseman as he approaches the bag. The left foot feels to the bag, is touching the bag, we're athletic, the hands are up, and we're prepared to come across with the right leg. As we feel with that left foot to the bag, the hands are up, we see the ball first, then we take a step with the right leg and we come across. And what we're trying to do here is to create an angle towards first base. Errors can occur on this turn where you come across aggressively towards the third baseman and then you're forced to change direction with your body. What we'd like to do is to create an angle towards first base to get more in the throw, more with your legs, and be more accurate. And now let's demonstrate the turn. Again, the second baseman's hands are up, he's athletic, the left foot is on the base, feeling for it. He evaluates the ball and sees it first, and then he comes across. You'll notice the left foot on the bag again with the hands up. He sees the ball, and once he sees it, then the right foot can come across. Notice the angle that they've created towards first base. They've created a little bit of angle towards first and not towards third base. You'll also notice the screen is short there, 15 to 20 feet, so your kids can get a lot of repetitions in a short amount of time. Not burning their arm out, but they can get into the repetition and the practice of making this turn. Again, this turn most likely will be from a third baseman or the shortstop giving you an underhand feed where you can flow into it and create momentum towards first base. The arm side turn. This is a throw that takes you away from first base. The throw is to your arm side, which pushes you off the bag towards left field at that angle. What's important here with your guys is to talk about the power of the right leg. It's very easy to want to open up. You can open your front side and create bad throws. As the ball takes us to that arm side, we're going to make that jump, but we need to stay strong on the right leg. Once you do catch, you're going to use that right leg to power it off. And on your release, you're thinking about throwing downhill so we can be strong. It's arm side, we catch and exchange, and then we use that right leg and power off it and think about throwing downhill here so we can be accurate and strong towards first base. Now an example after we walk through it. We've got a machine here coming from first base. You'll notice more infielders are now involved. I think it's important that all of your infielders work on all of the turns. It gives them the opportunity to improve and get better, but it also gives them the feeling to understand that if they're playing third base, they know what it's like as a second baseman when that throw takes them arm side, placing value on putting the throw over the center of the base. We'll demonstrate what we call the open up turn. This is a throw that takes the second baseman's angle where he's forced to open up that left foot. We talk a lot about splitting the body down the middle, and as that left foot feels onto the base, if the throw is to the left of that left foot, we can come across or create that angle. But if the throw splits it the other way, where it takes you slightly to your right, empower your guys to have this turn. This play will come up plenty. This is typically going to be from your shortstop into the six hole, or a ball that takes your shortstop up the middle, where he makes a glove side tabletop turn. The most important thing with your second baseman here is that he lets the ball travel. The hands are up, we're using the chest as our guide, but we want to let that ball travel, catch it first, then exchange, open up the left foot, and make the throw. Referring back to that force play slide diagram, as we open up that left leg, we are now on the outside of the base, and we're clear to throw. But again, let your guys allow the ball to travel. If they go out and get it, that'll affect posture, which will affect accuracy with the throw. And now again, here are our players in the drill setting. We showed it in a walkthrough example, and now here they are with a machine flipping them the ball. They're getting constant repetition from short throws, again allowing them to be prepared not to blow their arm out, but to give them high repetition, which can increase their confidence. Shortstop feeds. The angles will create the turn for you. If we can empower our players as coaches to have four basic turns, they're going to be in good shape. The terminology that we use is right, left, right, which is the underhand feed from the shortstop. The glove side middle tabletop, which is the ball that takes them to their left. The ball slightly to their right. And then the backhand and replace. We'll talk about those variables as we demonstrate. Here again are a couple of our freshman infielders just demonstrating what we call the right, left, right toss. A couple of things to notice here. We talk a lot about catching the ball on the glove side, but on this flip, the most efficient way to release the ball with strength to second is to catch the ball slightly on your right side or your arm side. The approach is right, left, catch, and then flip. So we call it the right, left, right feed. Again, what's important here is the exchange. Problems can occur where we catch it, we don't have a proper exchange or a grip on the ball. We bring our glove up to our belt, but we still don't have it in our hand, which forces us to toss downhill, which can create errors. It's right, left to catch, we secure an exchange, and now most important, we've got to clear that glove. Get that left glove out of the way so your second baseman has great vision. After we flip, we follow the throw aggressively. Right, left, right. Now here are our players in a practice setting just working on this right, left, right turn. In a typical practice day, we'll work on four or five of these turns at a high repetition. Again, notice, it's right, left to secure, and all of the players are working on securing that catch and clearing that glove, and then following the throw. We call this the glove side middle tabletop. The ball takes the shortstop either towards second base or even into an angle out towards the outfield grass. Most important thing here, we always talk about being under and behind. But on the catch, after we make the exchange, the most important thing to focus on here with your infielders is to keep that body down. We make the catch, we exchange it and flip, and then the body comes up. Again, if the body comes up early, we've got a chance to toss downhill, which can create errors. It's catch and exchange, it's flip uphill, and then the body comes up. Keep that body down. Shortstop on a ball to the right. A couple of different plays can happen here. But as the throw to the ground ball takes you to your right, we want to think about catching this thing on the arm side. If we're balanced at catch and we have the opportunity, the most efficient way is to slightly open up that glove side hip, keep the body down, and we're always talking about throwing uphill. Again here, balance in the lower half is critical. If the ground ball takes you hard to your right, you're going to have to use the strength of the right leg. Stay strong on that right leg and think about throwing uphill. As we talk about the backhand in terms of the shortstop feed, again, different variables will occur with the backhand. Could be a crossover situation, and if it is, again, always under and behind. And most important when we do crossover is to crossover, exchange it first, and then replace your feet, keeping the body down and remaining athletic. If the angle takes you to where your glove side or your left foot stays behind your right foot, make the exchange, keep your feet still, stay athletic within your lower half, and make the feed towards second base. Anytime we're on that backhand, it's under and behind, and it stays strong with that lower half. We're going to talk about five basic turns that could occur for your second baseman. The tabletop, the chest-to-chest or the underhand feed, a ball that takes you up the middle, which we call backhand underneath, the ball slightly to your left, and the glove side spin. We'll start with the tabletop feed. I think it's something in your program that should be in place. I think it's a turn that comes up a lot. And the angle of this ball determines this turn. On the tabletop, it allows your second baseman to not only come in, but on any ball that's going to take them to an angle to their right. The most important thing here is that we flip from the ground up, the exchange again being critical for any double play turn. We immediately take the left foot, then the right foot, then the catch. Your infielders can have problems here as they're constantly used to being to the outside or getting to the right of it. Well, now we've changed the angle. Our footwork becomes left, right, catch and exchange and flip, and then follow the feed. You'll notice here on our infielders that they'll slightly get to the left and create that angle and push it back to the right. Again, it's left, right, and flip. Most important thing on the backhand is to flip from the ground up. If we can secure that catch, we can still remain on top of the ball, flip, and then come up. If your hands come up to your belt without exchange, you've got a chance to toss downhill, making it difficult to see. You'll notice on this slide that with this angle, the vision for the shortstop is good if the flip is made from the ground up. We call this the chest-to-chest turn, and this is basically just an underhand feed from the second baseman. The difference between this turn and the tabletop is the freedom in that right leg. When it lands in front of catch, it's got a chance to block you off, forcing you into a tabletop. But if the angle of your movement to the baseball here keeps that right leg back, you're open and free to toss that ball to your shortstop in a chest-to-chest fashion. Just like the underhand feed from the shortstop is critical to stay under and beneath, make your exchange, and clear that glove so that shortstop has good vision. After toss, follow it aggressively to your target. Call this one backhand underneath. Simply a ball that takes a second baseman to the backhand side. The most efficient way to get the ball back to the shortstop is to make the catch on the backhand, and this is obviously a play that is extending you pretty good. Your momentum is taking you towards the middle of the field. You don't have time to set your feet here, so on this play on the backhand, make the catch, exchange the catch, and then flip it directly underneath your glove side arm. Keep that glove side arm up and flip it from underneath. This allows your shortstop to see it clearly. If there's action in the glove hand, you can distract your shortstop. We exchange it, we flip from underneath the glove, and it creates the most accurate feed to your shortstop. On the ball to the second baseman's left, we talk about one major theme, and that's replacing the feet. You'll notice with our infielders here, they'll get to the catch position, they're under and behind, but they remain athletic at catch. After the catch position, we tell our guys to simply replace your feet and release. This will keep the body down. We're still thinking about throwing uphill, but after catch it's simply a replace the feet and release. Remain athletic and strong with that lower half. We'll demonstrate two different types of glove side spins here. The second base feed on a double play turn from the second baseman, or on the right slide the third baseman on a spin. Either way, when the ball takes you hard to your left and you're moving aggressively, the most important thing is to replace your feet and to control your body. It's very easy to get out of control on these plays. As you make the catch, replace your feet and remain athletic, but most importantly, stay under control with your body. The second baseman will catch a glove side, replace the feet, and release. Your third baseman, you'll also notice a couple of things. After their pre-pitch position, which is athletic, their angle takes them into the six hole. That forces the body to spin around, and you're going to need an extra shuffle here. So after pre-pitch, have your guys work on that angle. They take it into the six hole, make the catch, they exchange it, they replace their feet, then they make a shuffle towards their target. On third base feeds, in terms of double play skills, what's the most important here after they get to their pre-pitch position is to understand the angle and the speed of the ball at which is hit. We'll demonstrate here with some video a three-step glove side, a ball that's a bullet or a one-step backhand, and then a play which takes them hard up the line at an angle or a three-step backhand. Three-step glove side. From a pre-pitch position, this is all about the initial angle and rhythm to the baseball. You'll notice our third baseman here, once they get to that pre-pitch position, the first action they make is with that front hip. The left hip slightly opens and they take an angle towards the six hole. This enables them to keep rhythm, stay under and behind, and after catch it's simply an exchange of the feet or a heel to heel towards their target. Again, what you're practicing here is that first pitch, pre-pitch, and a great angle initially towards the six hole versus coming across. Take the angle, under and behind, exchange defeat. There's four different turns for the first baseman. You have two basically behind the runner, a first and second situation, or the runner only at first base. The difference here is to give them the repetition of understanding the throws are going to be to the outside or the inside. On these two examples, we're behind the runner, again a first and second situation. Slide on the left, we're working on a backhand. We're always trying to get momentum towards our target. If you can create a backhand with a high hop, it will ensure you proper momentum. Notice on the backhand or the slide to the left, they have rhythm at pre-pitch, they stay to the left of the ball, make the backhand play, and then this is a glove to hip exchange with the baseball. After an exchange, it's heel to heel, and we follow the throw aggressively. The slide to the right, this is a ball that takes you up the line. Depending on the speed of your runner, you either come to first base and get the out, or if you have runners of lesser speed, both on base and at the plate, you can take this to the second baseman. Most important, just as we talked about earlier with glove side turns, is the ball takes you to extend your glove side, replace your feet, and stay strong on that right leg. And then you work repetitions with your first baseman of being on the base or runner first only, and now they're releasing to the inside. You notice they'll begin on the base, they'll shuffle off to an athletic pre-pitch position, and then they'll try to create rhythm towards the target. We're now staying inside on the throw. The catch-to-hip exchange remains constant, as well as heel-to-heel. On the ball that does take you up the line, we now have a tag play. Use the base. Catch a glove side, touch it with the right leg, and power off that base for the tag play at second. There's basically three different types of slow rollers. Our terminology is attack and recover, glove side attack, or right, left, right. We like to use terminology so we can get into our drills quicker and the guys know what we're working on. On the attack and recover, this is a ball where your guys come and get it. We're going to catch this glove side. We understand that the runner doesn't have the speed and we have a little more time. So we attack, make the catch glove side, and then after we exchange, we take a shuffle and throw. That's the recover. On the glove side attack, this is a ball that takes you straight in, and this is a throw on the run. We're going to catch this ball glove side and make a glove to hip exchange. We remain on the run and make the throw. On the right, left, right, primarily is going to be a play for your third baseman and your second baseman, as the angle in terms of after catch is hard to their left. The difference between the top two and the bottom center is where you catch the ball. On the right, left, right, we're going to catch this ball off of our right side. We use that terminology as that's the footwork. It's a right leg, a left leg to catch. Catch it on the arm side or off to the right, and then we throw off of the right leg. I think it's important for your infielders to give them all three. Tag plays. Your infielders are going to constantly work at that straight down tag or a drop tag. Remember, the ball travels much faster than our gloves do. Many times we will find ourselves safe at second base with improper tag technique with your infielders. We'll set a machine up at catching position or even on the mound and just work repetition of allowing the ball to travel. Most important when we get to the base is let it travel and think about catching it glove side and dropping the tag straight down. You can turn a drop tag into a sweep tag by not letting the ball travel. A sweep tag should occur when the ball takes you to your right, and you're forced to just tag blind. On the sweep tag, it's catch, it's sweep down, and finish high. Again, understand where your runners are sliding to. Most likely the back of the base. First base skills. The most important skill for a first baseman is to get to the base athletically and be ready to react. Most errors occur on the first base position where we make improper reads and we make our moves early. We've got to get position, see it first, and then react. The first drill that we're demonstrating is what we call a fungal rhythm drill. The first baseman is straddled on the base athletically, and we have a fungal over at second base. And what we're teaching them, whether we hit it in the air, two bounces, three bounces, or whatever you choose, is to see the ball first before you stride in to catch. We have a stationary pick. Your first baseman straddles the base, and this would demonstrate a throw coming from the pitcher, and he's just working on glove pick technique. Again, under and behind is critical. Keep your eyes behind your glove, and you're constantly thinking about on picks to rake through it. Our motion picks, the first baseman getting an opportunity to blast over to the base, simulating a ground ball, get to the bag athletic, see the baseball first, and then react to the pick. We'll use fungos, short throws from coaches, or even machines into the dirt. We call this next drill high air reads for the third baseman. They come to a pre-pitch athletic position. One area that can be difficult for third baseman is reading that initial first hop. Whether you use a machine, a side toss for a coach, or the coach tossing it up into the air themselves, you're trying to simulate that first hop as being high air. We'll give our guys repetition of getting to pre-pitch, pounding the ball into the ground, and then evaluating that high air. When you see that high air in the corners, come and get it. This is an opportunity for them to train their eyes and to categorize what high air reads are. As you come and get it, work to keep your eyes behind it and play through it. Jump drills. These plays happen. I think it's important to work with your guys and understand the technique of what's important. Whether it's a six hole or a second baseman jump, the most important thing here is to make the catch and exchange first and then get up in the air. You will notice infielders as they try to get up in the air without an exchange, they don't have anything on the throw. Catch it and exchange it first, and then most importantly, when we jump, jump straight up. If the body tends to fade, we won't get anything on the throw. Catch it and exchange it first, get straight up, and then think about throwing downhill. This is an example of the charts we use at Kentucky. This is at the end of the fall, a player percentage progression for our guys. If you have the opportunity to use charts, keep tabs on your infielders in terms of practice versus their practice statistics and their game statistics. And doing it on a daily basis can strengthen their mental skills. This is a weekly chart that we give our infielders. I think the great thing about these in terms of giving them to them once a week is that you can paint a visual for them. It can enable them to become mentally tougher. If they have off-the-field issues, or concentration issues, or self-talk issues, I think these charts can paint the picture in terms of what we're all trying to accomplish, to get our guys to be consistent and play the game one pitch at a time. I hope you've enjoyed our presentation on double play skills and infield position specifics. As you watch this feature defensive highlight video, I think it's awesome to look at it in terms of taking the practice and drills that we do and putting them into the game. The bottom line is these plays will come up, and most importantly, it matters. And it matters for your players that they know that your responsibility to them is high and that you're going to do your best job to prepare them to play. Providing that environment with various repetitions and lots of drills is the best way, in my opinion, to show your players that you care about them. Best of luck to you in your program. Enjoy the defensive highlights, and go Cats.
Out of my hand, 'cause I'm the guy you'll never find.